Thank you. I'm delighted to be here. I was wondering when the invitation was going to come. It's been about 4 years since the last time I was here, and I was thinking that it was getting a little embarrassingly long between invitations. But luckily, John swept in and asked me to be here, and I'm delighted to be here. So one of the things that I do when I am not sailing in Santa Cruz is that I serve as the chairman of the Safety at Sea Committee of U.S. Sailing. So U.S. Sailing, as you probably know, has something like 30 staff positions back in Portsmouth, Rhode Island. And then the entire rest of the organization is volunteer, and so that's where I fit. And for the last 5 years, I've been the chairman of the Safety at Sea Committee. I was asked by Gary Jobson to do this in about 2011, 2012, and I've jumped into it. This is my last year of doing it. We've served 3 year terms, and I've served 2 3-year terms, and now it's time to move on. A couple of the things that I've done in the last year, one of which was to, I've always wanted a publication that would go along with Safety at Sea courses. Santa Cruz Yacht Club has sponsored Safety at Sea courses in the past, and there are many of them up in the Bay Area with Berkeley Yacht Club and Richmond and Ensenal, St. Francis and San Francisco. But I've always wanted to have a text that went along with that. So over the last 6 months, I've written a book to accompany the Safety at Sea courses. In addition, I worked on an online course for people who want to take Safety at Sea education but don't live where seminars are being offered. And so that's now online too. And you can go to U.S. Sailing and take an online course with 8 different topics, some of which we'll be talking about tonight, but not that much. And those topics are helpful for anybody that's a cruiser or a racer and even power boater who wants to increase their safety at sea knowledge. Tonight's topic comes from, I was asked to speak at the Personal Flotation Device Manufacturers Association annual meeting. And this is a group that had actually hired me to do some work on introducing new life jacket standards to the US. And in the process of doing this, I simultaneously got this document from the Office of Boating Safety at the Coast Guard, which was their new strategic plan, their new 5-year strategic plan. And we're going to talk about that more in just a second. But as I read through the strategic plan, it was obvious that they wanted input on how to make this a better strategic plan. And as I read through it, I thought it had lots of opportunities to make it better. And so I wrote them a lengthy document on how I thought it ought to be changed, which led to this presentation. To their credit, the folks that were in the Office of Boating Safety took all of my suggestions and integrated them into this 5-year plan, and it now is a much better strategic plan as a result, or at least I think it is. So tonight's topic is sort of looking at boating accidents, sailing accidents in particular, but we're going to look more broadly at recreational boating, and just talk through how people get in trouble and how we can make boating safer. So the first question, we've got to start out with a quiz. So the first question is, in the last year, what percentage of drownings, this is only drownings, not other forms of things that can happen to you, drownings and recreational boat accidents happened on the Great Lakes, oceans, and the Gulf? So basically, the coast of the continental United States and the Great Lakes. What percentage of drownings occurred on the coast and then in the Great Lakes?
10%.
30. That's your answer. Good. This is unbelievable. So I would have thought like all of them. I mean, it just seems like such big waters and scary things. Only 8% of the fatalities occurred along the coast and in the Great Lakes of the U.S. The other 92% were inland. So if you're trying to solve boating fatality issues, you can talk to groups like you guys who are out there sailing in Monterey Bay and San Francisco and, you know, doing all, or you can actually focus on where the fatalities are occurring, which is in the center part of the country. Okay, question number two. 50% of the drownings occurred in waves of less than what height?
4 inches.
So what this is saying is, that you take all of the drownings, and then you sort of say half of them occurred over this wave height, half of them occurred below this wave height. What's that wave height? 2 feet or 2 inches?
4 inches.
2 feet?
4 feet.
4 inches.
4 inches? Okay. So the answer is 6 inches.
Yeah.
So drownings occur half the time in stuff that we consider calm water. Calm water. Okay, third question and last question. What percentage of the drownings occurred in water less than 40 degrees Fahrenheit? Is this a hypothermia problem?
Zero.
Right? I mean, it's really cold in Monterey Bay, not 40 degrees perhaps. What percentage of the deaths occurred less than 40 degrees?
0.
3%. The other 97% occurred in normal conditions. So, the problem with this intro is that I'm sort of focused on those cold, rough, windy conditions out in the blue water. And in fact, that's not where people get into trouble. Right? They get into trouble in inland waters. But we still lose sailors every year, and power boaters, but mostly sailors, in blue water. So let's talk about this. So sailing's pretty safe. If we look at the last 6 years, 7 years, I guess, here, of fatalities, we lose about 24 sailors per year nationwide. And you think, well, oh, no, what about when Low Speed Chase went up on the Farallons? It didn't really make that big a difference in the statistics. We had a really bad year in 2012 because of Aegean and of Low Speed Chase. But 2012, we had 27 fatalities. It just fit in right within all the other fatalities. So the chance of drowning ends up being about 65%. And it's just slightly less of a problem with sailors than it is with all recreational boaters. The average for recreational boaters is closer to 70%. Total fatalities for all types of boating is about 659. So the total attributed to sailors, 3.6%. Now, my immediate reaction is that's because we're better at going offshore than power boaters, but that's not true. There are a lot fewer of us, is where we start. Sailing probably accounts for about 10% of the activities, and power boating is closer to 85% or so. And you know, so when we start getting all high and mighty about the fact that fewer of us die, we gotta look that there are a lot fewer sailors. Most people enjoy going out on small power boats and fishing and wakeboarding and doing that sort of stuff. So let's take a quick review of sailing accidents over the last 5 years. Those of you who have heard me give this talk before, I'm going to very briefly go over this just to kind of level set what has happened in recent years. Does anybody know where this happened? Yeah, right out at, in front of Castle Beach or Twin Lakes Beach, Seabright Beach, I guess. Yeah, this was a boat that was anchored out there about 2 years ago and got swept in during a winter storm. It's amazing we don't have more of these. So how many people die in these sailing activities? How can we prevent it? Should you put your affairs in order before you go offshore and so forth? So we'll start with Wingnuts. Wingnuts was was in the middle of 2011. This is a Kiwi 35, a radical 35-foot boat, weighed about 4,000 pounds, very lightly ballasted, lots of sail area, went out in the Chicago Mack race and was blown over in the middle of the night around 1 a.m. when all things go to hell. And two of the crew members were drowned underneath her because they couldn't escape from the capsized boat. And when she went over, like a multi-hull, she stayed upside down. Now, what does this boat remind you of any boat that you've seen in recent memory? Remember, we used to have the Moore 30s, and we used to have some other very beamy, very lightly ballasted boats. These boats depend on the movable ballast of the crew in order to keep them upright. And when they invert, they're so flat and beamy that they stay upside down. I had a Viper 640, some of you probably remember, that was in the dry storage yard, and I capsized it between the wharf and mile buoy, and it went over, and it stayed upside down with its little keel pointing in the sky. So, not a great attribute for an offshore boat. Later that year, 2011, we had Rambler 100, also known as Speedboat. Speedboat was participating in the Fastnet race, and she was about 4 or so miles away from Fastnet Rock, which you can see in the background of this picture. When her keel fell off, the entire keel fell off, so that there was nothing left except the dagger board, which is what you see in this picture. The 22 crew members all survived, which is really good news, because this is a situation that could have killed many people. Peter Eisler was down below. He was a navigator. And when the boat rolled over, by the time he got to the microphone to try to broadcast to Mayday, the mast had already hit the water. And soon thereafter, the boat continued to 180 degrees. And this is kind of superimposed, but you can see a rescue boat in the background. And the crew members, 17 of the crew members on top of the inverted boat, 5 of them floated away and were rescued by a different boat. No fatalities. Low Speed Chase, April 14th, 2012. Low Speed Chase is Sydney 38, just like Animal and Aboriginal. Was sailing around the Farallones on the fully crewed Farallones race. Was hit by a large wave that was unexpected, but not statistically improbable, and was washed up on the shore with a loss of 5 lives. Of the 3 that did not die, 1 was on board the boat all the way up onto the rocks, and 2 of them were thrown into the water with self-inflating high buoyancy life jackets, and they were able to climb ashore. 2 weeks later, on the Newport Ensenada race, a boat called Aegean, which was a Hunter 376, was sailing down to Ensenada and ran into North Coronado Island. And if you look at this path, we can see her starting here in this perfectly straight line going down to North Coronado Island, which is a skinny island, and it was aligned with the direction of her travel. And the reason that she hit it is because she was under autopilot, because this is one of these races that allows you to use power and an autopilot. So she was powering along at 7.1 knots and ran into the end of the island with a loss of 4 crew members. Next, we have the Islands race, which was the next year. Different island, but still in Southern California. And this was a Columbia Carbon 32, which lost its rudder someplace in here. This is San Clemente Island. And then was pushed every 15 minutes closer and closer onto this lee shore, and finally went up on the lee shore with the loss of one of her crew members. There's a lawsuit going on right now over this. This is 2013. And they had almost 2 hours to figure out what to do, but they did not ask the Coast Guard for help. And they thought that they could figure this out and fix the situation on their own. You remember in the 34th America's Cup, Artemis was out sailing near Treasure Island, between Alcatraz and Treasure Island, and just the boat just basically broke up. And in the process, Bart Simpson was drowned underneath this. These are the strongest materials that we know how to create: Cuban fiber, carbon fiber, epoxy resin. And even though they were able to get to him within 10 minutes, he was drowned. Vestas Wind went up on Cargados Carajos Shoal in the western Indian Ocean during the Volvo Ocean Race. In 2014, no fatalities, but they put a 65-foot modern race boat up on the bricks. This is a perfectly charted shoal that is bigger than Monterey Bay, and they still managed to hit it because they did not practice good navigational techniques. The boat was rebuilt, and 5 months later, it completed the last two legs of the Volvo Ocean Race. This was a race down in Mobile Bay. I'm trying to think of the name of this now. It escapes me for the moment, but this is a video that was shot. Dauphin Island, the Dauphin Island race. This was shot on a Catalina 36, where this monster squall came through when they had something like 100 boats on Mobile Bay, six fatalities, six boats sank, and they just were completely unprepared for what happened. And this is what drives organizing authorities and race committees and safety boat operators crazy, that a squall will come through at this magnitude and will knock boats over. Three of the six people that drowned were wearing Coast Guard approved life jackets. And you're at short chop, warm water, and you start to aspirate water, and you can't maintain an airway, and you drown wearing a life jacket. So if we look at what conclusions we can draw from this, it falls into several categories. And I was trying to think, what are the themes here that we've got to worry about? Well, we didn't talk about the 420, because it wasn't a big boat, but this was a 420 that resulted in a fatality. So the issues that I came up with were that five of these had stability issues, where the boats were less stable and didn't take care of their crews. They generally capsized and stayed capsized. Life jackets were a problem in six of these incidents, where the life jackets didn't perform as the crew members anticipated that they would perform. Navigation was a problem in four of these because they ran into islands that were on charts. And you know, we tend to use islands as turning marks and as marks of race courses. But if you think about Southeast Farallon Island, San Clemente Island, North Coronado Island, Cargadas Carajos Shoal, all of these things were in our race courses when we ran into them. And finally, navigation. High-tech designs. I'm not saying that this was because they were high-tech designs, but five of the 10 boats were kind of cutting-edge designs. So life jackets, which is, I was talking to this life jacket group, life jackets failed to protect the people in five out of these nine instances. So, and here's one more. This is Cheeky Rafiki. Cheeky Rafiki was a Beneteau 40.5 that was coming back across the Atlantic, and the keel tore off. And this is a production boat that isn't a bad boat. Then the keel tore off, the boat capsized, and the four crew members were lost. Cape Fear 38, Cynthia Woods, was repaired several times, but it had a very small contact patch between the keel and the bottom of the hull. The keel fell off, boat capsized, one of the six crew members was killed. And finally, Polina Star, an Oyster 825, which was extended to 90 feet, one of the most expensive production boats you can possibly imagine, the keel fell off. And when it did, the boat sank, and no crew members were lost, and the boat was eventually recovered, and the keel was recovered, and it was constructed so poorly, it just staggers the imagination. So one of the results of this talk should be that you ought to think about the stability of the boats that you go to sea on, because when the keel falls off, and I have personal experience with this, when the keel falls off, people die. And it doesn't matter if it's a multi-hull capsizing or a monohull with the keel falling off, it's a very unsafe situation. So who's at risk? Now, this is the second part of the presentation. This is where I looked at this strategic plan for boating safety, and I did not like what I saw. So I created this presentation. From the National Recreational Boat Strategic Plan that covers all of us for the next 5 years, which is sort of the Coast Guard's mandate for how to reduce fatalities, I came upon a couple of statements which I thought were interesting. The first one is, this COA, I can't remember what COA is, cause of action or something. Does anybody know what COA is in government speak? Cause of action targets highest risk populations by implementing a variety of media campaigns designed to increase safe boating behaviors. So the first thing they're telling you is they're going to spend taxpayer dollars on media campaigns to make you put on your life jacket. That's really what that says. And so they said design a targeted life jacket campaign for boaters in high risk populations.
Who's high risk?
Who's high risk? Who is that? Yeah, inland maybe, power boaters maybe, people that drink too much maybe.
Yeah. That's a good one.
But it didn't define high-risk populations. Next one said, implement an evidence-based effective campaign targeting the highest causality risks and the highest risk groups for each desired behavioral change. Blah, 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 blah. Okay, and then the final one says, COA 5 focuses on regulatory action aimed at improving the visibility of side lights on vessels smaller than 12 meters, updating boating accident reporting criteria, revising carriage requirements to reflect newly or available technology, and promoting life jacket wear for high-risk boating. So here's this concept of high-risk boating. And I kept on thinking, who are they talking about? Who are these high-risk boaters? So, it depends on your perspective. In some cases, we think that it might, the sailors think it's power boaters think it's sailors, who knows? This is one of my favorites. Wait, wait, cancel that, I guess it says health. So where do we get the data that we use to try to make these decisions? Well, we get it from two different publications that are annual. These are published, one by the Coast Guard and one as a result of a Coast Guard grant. The first one is Recreational Boating Statistics, which is a compilation of all 50 states plus DC plus the six trust territories, and it takes all of the boating accident reports that are generated and puts them together to try and figure out how safe we are in recreational boats. So the information comes from the states and the trust territories and the District of Columbia, and it's compiled into this annual document. The second document is a $250,000 grant that looks at how many people wear life jackets. How do they figure out if you wear life jackets? Yes, they observe you. So across all 50 states, there are people with binoculars standing on the ends of jetties, watching people go in and out of harbors, estimating their ages, and then determining whether they're life jacket wearers or not. Okay, so those are the two documents that I based most of my presentation on. So the first C word, these are all C words. The first C word is capsizing. And, you know, we have a lot of evidence of capsizing, including there's Oracle in the fall of 2012, pitch pulling off the St. Francis, and lasers and all. You know, we have lots of capsizes. And so, why is capsizing dangerous? Puts people in the water. Right? Some may have life jackets, some may not have life jackets, but it puts people in the water. It's like hitting a fixed object and everybody gets ejected from the boat. So, and in this case, capsizing was really dangerous. We know that it killed 2 out of the 8 crew members on Wingnuts. This is the Coast Guard climbed on board their boat in the middle of the night and put a flashing beacon on it, because other boats were sailing past it and couldn't see it. They didn't want somebody to collide with it. So if we take a look at the reports from the Coast Guard on this annual report, And we say, how many people died of capsizing? Well, there's capsizing. And so we can sort of look, there are 299 accidents and 309 vessels and 129 drowning deaths and 170 total deaths. So if we just look at capsizing, that's 27.2% of the total of fatalities. So that's a pretty big number. We're already found a quarter of these fatalities. Now, these can be kayaks, they can be dinghies, they can be bass boats that go over lakes, all sorts of people capsize. So if we look by vessel type and break this down a little bit, kayak is the number one capsizing fatal thing, right? 82 fatalities. Interestingly, open motorboats, also 82 fatalities. And canoeists are there at about 48 fatalities. And so two of the three are human-powered craft. So if we want to solve capsizing issues, look towards little tippy boats, right? But the other category, open motorboat, that's the big category. That's what people do. That's the kind of boats they own across the United States. They don't own Catalinas, they own open power boats. So these three constitute 69% of all capsizes. So again, this is, you know, this isn't good or bad, it's just sort of digging into the data to try to figure out if you were responsible for reducing fatalities amongst recreational boaters in the United States, you do this kind of analysis, you dig into the data and you try to figure out, how can I save these people, right? And then if we get down to things like sail only, I mean, it's like nine people. It's just not, it's not the number, that's not driving this. Okay, next let's look at canoe and kayak. Well, this is gonna overlap that capsize number a little bit because we're just looking at boat type now. But one of the things about canoes and kayaks is that you can go to a sporting goods store and buy them. You can buy them at Westbury, you can buy them at the Kayak Connection, you can buy them at REI, but you can go to sporting goods places that have no safety education, and you can put it in the back of your pickup truck, and you can take it down to the launch ramp, and launch it, and go kayaking, or go canoeing. That's not, I'm not saying that a lack of boater education is the causality, but at the same time, nobody's stopping you from going out there and being uneducated about boating safety. So, 139 fatalities, or 22%, were attributed to kayaks and canoes in 2015, compared to 10% in 2005. So in 10 years, the proportion went from 10% to 22%. Why do you think that is? Are kayakers suddenly getting crazy out there? It's crazy popular. Right? We've got racks full of kayaks all over the harbor that didn't used to exist. When I was growing up here, there was no kayak rack. There was an El Toro rack, right? Now there's kayak racks. So if we look at fatalities by boat type, this is a graph that I asked the Coast Guard to put into this annual document because I thought it showed the changes of who is getting into trouble. And this big maroon area, that's open power boats. And immediately you say, well, yeah, that's half the deaths. But it's going down, right? It's above 50% here, and it's slowly going down. So open power boats are responsible for fewer and fewer fatalities over time. How about this big green area up here? That looks like it's getting bigger. And that's where I've combined rowboats, SUPs, which are not that popular, I mean, not that big a deal, kayaks and canoes. And if you look at it, that's getting bigger. So while overall fatalities are going down, the portion of the pie that's getting bigger is manually powered craft. And if we look at rowboats are getting safer over time because this part of the graph is getting smaller. Canoes are about the same. Kayaks are where the fatalities are increasing. Because of popularity, you know, because people take them out and go fishing when it's cold, they capsize and they can't self-rescue. And then if we look at this graph, this is a little complicated, but this shows of the type, by boat type, which things are increasing in fatal accidents. Pontoon boats, inflatables, and combined paddle are where the boats, the deaths are increasing. Open motor boats are decreasing, personal watercraft decreasing, and other decreasing. Okay, how about cold water? We, you know, the rest of the country, except for the Pacific Northwest, there are very few places that boat in as cold water as we do. In the winter, we're around 50 Fahrenheit. In the summer, it's 60 or 62 Fahrenheit. It's really cold. Hypothermia is a constant concern of ours. And so, if you actually look at this, in 2015, only 13 deaths were attributed to hypothermia. That doesn't mean that people didn't drown or get really cold and not be able to self-rescue, but actual hypothermia as a cause of death, only 13 out of 650. So 119 deaths occurred in waters less than 60 degrees, but those weren't necessarily hypothermic deaths. They were just people that were out there boating when it was cold. So I tried to figure out how to analyze this. And I looked at water temperature versus accidents and deaths. And we accidents have the disadvantage of being underreported because you don't have to report an accident, but all the deaths get reported. And so the shape of these curves is really similar, but the one that makes the most sense is really this orange one because the orange one is fatalities. So if you look at this, what it says is that there's not a lot of boating going on during cold water. Here's 60 degrees up here, and below that, it's about 90 fatalities. People are actually out there boating in warm water. Duh. I mean, that's what I would want to be boating if I didn't live in Santa Cruz. So the number of fatalities due to hypothermia turns out to be relatively few. If we also look at when people wear life jackets, this is the air temperature, and this is the percentage of people that are wearing life jackets. So when the air temperature is less than 60, 10% of the people wear life jackets in powerboats. In sailboats, almost 30% of the people wear life jackets when the air temperature is 60. And in paddle sports, 80% of the people wear life jackets when the water, when the air temperature is less than 60. Why is this important? What it just says is that people self, how would you say this? That they choose to wear life jackets when it's cold. But when it gets warm, they strip off those life jackets. And in fact, in this 90 to 99 degree temperature, fewer than half of the paddle sports people are wearing life jackets, and sailors are down to 15%, powerboaters are down to 3%. So it's an interesting thing because we're saying when people dress appropriately, they automatically put on life jackets. But when it gets hot, they say, screw it, I'm not going to wear a life jacket. How about collisions out there or getting catapulted out of the boat? Collisions, that poor guy who ran into Perkins' boat, that was probably a bad day for him. 105 or 17% of the fatalities have their accident type as collision. 3% of the fatalities are due from ejection from vessel. So how many have seen this picture before? Right? That looks like a bad day on the water. But what you don't know is what happens next. This is what the boat looked like after the whale hit it. That is just terrible. So once again, if we look at collisions by the type of boat, open motorboats are involved in the vast majority of collisions, then personal watercraft, then cabin motorboats. So these three powerboat classes constitute 81% of the collisions. If you're going to be in a collision with another boat, I know you're thinking about the starting line and it's at the Santa Cruz Yacht Club. you really have to watch out for open motorboats because they're the ones you get you. You know, here's where sail only is just like no, insignificant. How about capacity? We've all seen boats that have gone out in the Delta or San Francisco or Lake Tahoe. They've just got this pile of people on them. It's just like, are you kidding me? You got, you know, so we don't want to be a spoil sport. We want to encourage people to come on board. I remember when I was the designated captain of promotion, we were going to limit the number of people that could be on the boat to 12. This is a 40-foot sailboat. Who wants to go sailing with 11 other people on a 40-foot sailboat? But we do. We tend to overload our boats. This was right before this McGregor 26 capsized in San Diego with the loss of a couple of lives. And it was tragic. Some of the people couldn't swim and they're out there. But look at the boat. I mean, somebody must have said to themselves, this is not good seamanship. But they didn't. How about this one? Yeah, do you think they had enough life jackets on board? Probably not.
Temperature was 90.
So if we look at overloading, 29 accidents, 9 deaths, it doesn't turn out to be that big a deal. It looks bad, but you know, if all the people on that pontoon boat fell over, they'd probably cling onto it. Nobody would die. Okay, overloading accidents. Open motorboats are the ones where you get problems. So, as I was putting this together, I heard about an accident on Catalina, off of Catalina, where there was a 15-foot boat with 7 people in it.
Jeez.
And they were in large waves, and the boat capsized, and 3 of the 7 died. So that's definitely a problem. Little boats, unstable, remote areas, that's really bad and problem. How about competency? Well, we've got 2 different versions of competency here. One which is a daytime or nighttime accident where somebody didn't know where the breakwater was. But how many of us have seen this going out of Santa Cruz Harbor?
Many of us.
This is the thing that drives me crazy. I want to take the parents aside and beat them up. I can't believe that parents would allow their kids to sit on a boat, especially with reverse shear, so the kid just slides off and disappears, and by the time the parents can get to the throttle, that kid is in the propeller. So you should shout at people going down the Santa Cruz Channel and tell them, get your kid off the bow. Happens all the time. As it turns out, where boating education is known, 220 out of 310 deaths occurred on a boat where the skipper had no boating education. But 90 of the deaths occurred where somebody did have boating education, either from Coast Guard Auxiliary or U.S. Sailing or Mark Craft or somebody. So it isn't that boating education is like perfectly aligned with safe boating. Because 90 folks had some approved course and still got into a fatal accident. Okay, so here's the pie chart. 71% had no education, 14% got it from the internet, 14% got it from a state course, 2% got it from the power squad. Okay, finally, we're almost going to wrap up here. How often are conditions the reason that somebody gets in trouble? Here's one of our last C words. Whether it's traveling too far from shore or traveling at night, how many of you have gone into a harbor at night and there's so many lights coming from the shore? You can't see anchored boats. You can't see navigation lights. You couldn't see rocks. I mean, or in our area, where it's so common to have dense fog. We can't find the wharf, can't find the mile buoy. So if you look at when people get into trouble though, they get into trouble in calm conditions. And only 5% get into trouble when the waves are over 6 feet. Similarly with wind strengths, light air is responsible for 48% of the fatalities. and storm conditions of over 25 knots, only 4%. Now, once again, if you're a statistician, what would you say about this, these two pie charts?
We're going out on good days.
Right. People go boating when the weather is good. They don't go out in storms unless you race in Santa Cruz. But for the most part, we go out when the weather is nice, so this is sort of self-fulfilling prophecy. Finally, we're going to talk about life jacket wear rates. And wear rates, again, the percentage of people on board a boat observed, not self-proclaimed, but observed, that are wearing life jackets. So these are the conditions: sunny, partly cloudy, cloudy, raining, and stormy. So as it turns out, when power boaters, we're slightly more are more likely to wear life jackets when it's stormy. Sailors start out at 20% when it's sunny and get as high as 31% when it's stormy. Well, at least we're using some logic here, both power boaters and sailors. And paddle craft, they have this kind of weird thing here where it dips down, but over 70% of them are wearing life jackets in stormy conditions. I should hope so. How about cocktails, cans, and containers? Boating under the influence is implicated in 19% of boating accidents reported. And you know, this is just the scene. You know, it's Party Cove. Everybody's getting gassed. This is a picture I found online. Bad choice of beer, but at least they were throwing that before.
Exploitation.
So deaths due to alcohol and drug use, 101. Again, this is 101 out of roughly 650 fatalities. So maybe it's 16% or so. I'm going to skip that. Finally, I thought maybe people that are in competition, sailboat competition, wakeboard competition, maybe that's the problem. But they don't really record this. But skiers, there were about 12 skier fatalities and 16 non-skier fatalities, total of 28. It's really popular. That's only like 3%. So it's probably not due to wakeboarding and water skiing. Finally, this was a statement which I was blown away at: closeness to home. Research suggests that most recreational boating accidents occur in close proximity to the boat operator's home port, indicating that boating risk factors depend on recreational boater operator behaviors patterns specific to those trips. What they're saying is, if you're close to home, you're more likely to be involved in a boating accident. Duh!
The other way around.
Right? So, where do we mostly boat? Close to home. Where are the accidents more likely to occur? Where we boat? Close to home. I couldn't believe this, so I was trying to figure out if there's a way to prove this. And so what I did is I looked at accidents by distance away from home. And what this says is that 23% of the accidents occur in the first mile. And by the time you get out to 20 miles away from home, 83% of the accidents have occurred. So, but this turns out to be, for cars. So it's like always true. You know, it's true with boats, it's true with cars, it's probably true with airplanes. They, you know, crash when they land and they take off. I don't know. But my point is that this is a dumb thing to put into a statistical publication. Okay. So a couple more here. Okay, so when we look at statistics like this, I remember a phrase that a statistician that I used to work with used to say. He said, garbage in, gospel out. And so you've got to, the world is a lot messier than simply looking at these statistics. And so as I was looking at statistics, I thought, well, let's look at this life jacket wear rate. Okay, life jacket wear rate for cabin sailboats. The first set of numbers that you're going to look at are from 2002 to 2005, so over a four-year period. And this is the wear rate. I know it doesn't look like much because I haven't shown you the bottom axis. But what it shows you is that about 10% of the people were wearing life jackets on cabin powerboats. Cabin sailboats. Then if we look at 2013 to 2014, what's the statistic that you see there?
A lot more wearing.
Dramatic increase in the number of people wearing life jackets, right? We've gone from whatever this number is to this number. We've gone from whatever this number is to this number. In all cases, except for this outlier, and this one, I guess, more people were wearing life jackets 10 years later. So good news, because when you wear life jackets, you don't drown for the most part. Yes?
Did they require kids to wear life jackets somewhere in that study?
Let's see, the mandatory wearing for kids was around 2000. I don't actually know when it was. But this, I believe, is the adult wear rate. Yes?
So do you think the increase in usage is attributable to change in design, for example? You know, the old orange around the neck were kind of...
I'm going to ask you to hold that until I show you two more slides, and then you tell me if you think that's the case. Okay, so here's where all these statistics were. In Tiburon, this was by far the highest wear rate of any place in the United States. One of the second place ones was Oakland. The average of all sites was here. So everything at this site is wearing life jackets at a greater rate. In San Diego, which is the same state as Tiburon and Oakland, you're down at 4%, right? But in Tiburon, the observed wear rate was 54%. 54%. Now, I think, well, I'm going to get back to Joe in just a second. And then, so if we analyze this in these different time frames, this is San Diego, this is Tiburon. This is San Diego, this is Tiburon. These are just different time frames. San Diego, all around 3 to 4%. Tiburon, boom, 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 on up. And for inflatables, this was the percentage of people wearing inflatables in Tiburon. So 57%, 52%, I don't know why this dropped down to 28%, back up to 52%.
Is that the percentage of the people wearing any kind of a life jacket?
Yes. So of the observed people wearing life jackets, 52% of them were wearing inflatable life jackets. I think this, to some degree, is the low-speed chase influence. And yet low-speed chase happened in 2012, so it would have been in here someplace. So in the Bay Area, people were wearing life jackets at a much higher rate than they were in San Diego, even before low-speed chase went up on the bridge. Sir?
Do these numbers discriminate between racers and non-racers?
They don't make the distinction between racers and non-racers. They do try to identify the age of the wearer, and so they actually have really good child versus adult wear rates statistics. But they only make a distinction between open sailboats and cabin sailboats. And I think I used cabin sailboats here. But I just find this amazing.
It's so warm in San Diego.
Pardon me?
The warmth factor. They don't want to wear it just too warm.
Well, that's a good theory. Right? That's a good theory. So if you're, once again, if you're trying to look at these statistics and you look at California and it says 22% or 23%, you say, that's good, California. And then you look at how it breaks out. We've got two different states here. Of course, we've always said so, right? We've always said that. So, okay, that's the end of my statistical analysis. Thank you very much. Questions, Joe?
Well, what I was alluding to was, you know, the new design, the life vest that's self-inflating, it's much smaller, comfortable, easier to use, if that had, you know, anything to do with the increased popularity. But also I want to ask your comment, if you wanted to comment on the self-inflating life vest. It's a fairly new design, and there has been some discussion recently whether it could be a help or a hindrance. For example, if you revoke turtles and you're caught in the cabin in the water, your vest inflates, how do you swim out from there?
Okay, so two different questions. First, do we think that inflatable life jackets in general have increased wear rate? And I would say that they have
for what I would think of as sort of sophisticated users. And by that I mean guys, Santa Cruz Yacht Club members who either are required to wear it because of racing or choose to wear it because they know they're in a rough water, cold water area. So I think inflatable life jackets, which have been on the market for over 20 years, maybe not Coast Guard approved, but this is not a new phenomenon. I remember delivering non-Coast Guard approved inflatables to boats when I worked in the Palo Alto store of West Marine. So, I mean, this goes way back. So the first answer is, yes, inflatables, I think, have encouraged certain people who are prone to wearing life jackets anyway to have a higher wear rate. The second question is between what I would call a manually inflated life jacket, one that requires you to pull the ripcord, versus a water-activated one. And this discussion has come up because a guy from the CCA, whose initials are HL, I don't know his last name, but this guy got an article published recently where he believes that water-activated inflatables are dangerous. And he bases this on a number of studies. So of the studies that we talked about with Wingnuts and Aegean and Polina Star and all these different vessels, I either wrote or was the editor or picked the editors of most of those reports. And so I've been really involved in this over the last, very sad thing to have to do, but I've been involved in this intensely. And there are some instances where people died because their life jackets inflated and they could not escape an inverted boat. The one example in particular is Wingnuts, where the deceased were found connected to the vessel, upside down in the cockpit with inflated life jackets, and you could draw the conclusion that had the life jackets not inflated, maybe they could have gotten out from underneath it. Second example is Peter Eisler, who purposely did not wear a life jacket when he escaped from Rambler 100, because he figured as soon as he was swimming underneath the cockpit of the boat trying to get to the, this is a 24-foot beam boat, so he has to swim a minimum of 12 feet to get to the side of the boat. He didn't want the buoyancy. And so what he did is he dove through the companionway, swam laterally, got to the lifelines, realized he was running out of breath. The lifelines are right there like a fence going the wrong direction. Swam under the lifelines, saw a boot, kind of grabbed for the boot, and the guy that was wearing the boot grabbed him by the shoulders and pulled him out of the water. So he very nearly didn't make it. But those instances are in situations where the boat remained inverted. And we just have to get away from that being a thing that we worry about. Boats that invert and stay inverted are terrible sea boats. They put people's lives at risk. This is true to some degree with multi-hulls. I mean, when multi-hulls capsize, when I sailed on PlayStation, I wore a manually inflating life jacket, and I had a big knife on the side of my hip, and the knife had one of these serrated blades. It was a diving knife. And the idea was, when you went over and you were underneath that net, you were to take the knife out and cut the net and pull yourself through the trampoline, because otherwise you were going to drown before you could ever swim to the beam of the boat, because it was a 60-foot beam, so minimum of 30 feet. So my point is that if you start to worry about capsize and entrapment, you know, you start making really bad decisions, I think, in the majority of cases. The other instance, which is the 420, remember I said I wasn't going to talk about the 420? Well, this is Olivia Constance, who was drowned underneath her 420 while sailing off of the Naval Academy. And she was wearing a Type 3 life jacket, a dinghy life jacket. And she accidentally got hooked into the trapeze wire as the boat capsized. And so the boat went over, and now she's being held down by her own trapeze wire. And the problem is that when you take the hook and invert it 180 degrees, you can't slip it off. You can't get it out of the little hole that it's attached to. And she was held underwater, and then 3 minutes later, she was drowned and dead. So Does that mean the dinghy sailors shouldn't wear life jackets because they might be entrapped? We have Aussie 18 sailors, Aussie 18 sailors who have been trapped underneath their inverted Australian 18s because they're in the trapeze and they can't free themselves. So it's a tough decision. And the place where I come out on this isn't that one is better than the other, because you can always find an example where somebody died, and had they not had that device, they would have lived. Wing nuts, this 420 sailor, there are a variety of, Rambler 100. But the biggest issue, I think, is cold shock. So that when you're out there, and you're tending to some spinnaker, and the boat rolls, and you fall into the water, and the first thing you do is you inhale. You go... And when you do that, if your mouth is underwater, you start to drown. And if you then have to find the ripcord on your life jacket to pull it, to inflate it, that's a big complicated thing to have to do, because your reaction is, get me to the surface. You're wearing life jacket, you're wearing a foul weather gear, get me to the surface, and you just don't have the wherewithal to find the ripcord. When Brian Chong went in the water on the second wave of the capsized low-speed chase, his life jacket inflated, he bobbed to the surface, and then he had to struggle with his life jacket, but he survived. And I asked him about 2 weeks after the incident, I said, hey Brian, had you had a manual inflating life jacket, could you have inflated it? And he said, something like not in 1,000 years. He said there was no way, he was too busy trying to just survive. So, there isn't a right and wrong answer. There are really good discussions on either side of it. But anybody that has a super strong opinion about this is the way it ought to be hasn't read the reports. Because you can really find both sides well represented in the reports. Yes?
How often does it happen that an inflatable fails to inflate?
So the Royal National Lifeboat Institute, which is the volunteer Coast Guard of the United Kingdom, does a lot of boardings, just like the Coast Guard Auxiliary and Coast Guard does. And they inspected over 10,000 inflatable life jackets over the course of a couple of years. And in their statistics, they said 11% were not ready to inflate for whatever reason. And you know, there are a number of failure modes of an inflatable life jacket. You might have an expired used CO2 cylinder, you might have it not screwed in correctly, you might not have it at all, for lots of reasons. So they came up with about 11%, which puts the onus on all of us to make sure that when we go and we put on a life jacket, we make sure that the CO2 is ready to go. Yes, Ben.
Chuck, has the industry ever thought of marketing a warm weather life jacket, like whether it be belt or whatever, because as you said, most of the drownings occur in warm water. People don't want to wear life jackets. Is there such a thing as a
yes.
Warm
jacket? Yes, and as you get away from the West Coast and San Francisco and so forth, you have a lot more mesh used in life jackets that are inherently buoyant. And you have belt packs, but the belt packs, surprisingly, West Marine, at kind of the heyday of inflatable life jackets, West Marine sold about 40,000 in a year. And as I recall, about 3,500 were belt packs. So you would think, oh, why would I wear a stole type when I could wear a belt pack? It just never seemed to be that super, super popular. Everybody should be aware that if you wear a belt pack, whether you're sailing, whatever, paddling, what's called secondary donning. You fall into the water, you find the ripcord, you inflate it, this thing pops out in front of you, and then you have to take it and jam it over your head. And the Coast Guard was very reluctant to have life jackets that were Coast Guard approved that required secondary donning for that reason. I don't know that it's been a problem. I don't know about the number of fatalities that have been caused because someone wasn't able to do that, but it is an incremental risk. Yes?
What's your opinion about the modern life jackets for dinghy sailors? They're relatively small, they have a little bit of padding on the back. What's your safety record there?
So the, you know, in the U.S., the minimum life jacket buoyancy for ever since we were in boating has been 15 and a half pounds of buoyancy. 15 and a half pounds of buoyant force. So in, if you were in Europe, you wouldn't talk about pounds of buoyant force, you'd talk about newtons. And so that's equivalent to about 70 newtons. In Europe, you're allowed to wear life jackets in certain conditions that have 50 newtons. So they are 28% less buoyant than Coast Guard approved life jackets. And they're slimmer, and they're easier to wear, and they got more flexibility, and they're great, except they have less buoyancy. So the question is, where can you compromise and allow somebody to have less buoyancy and still be safe? So one of the things I mentioned earlier, well, I don't know if I actually said the number, but 70% of the people drown as a cause of death in recreational boating accidents. Of those, 85% are not wearing life jackets. But 15% are wearing life jackets, and they still manage to drown.
Okay.
So that's roughly, 15%, 75 people a year drown, not just die, but drown wearing Coast Guard approved life jackets. So the question for the Coast Guard and for underwriters' laboratories and for boating experts is to try to figure out how many people are you going to allow to die wearing Coast Guard approved life jackets to get people to wear more life jackets, right? Because wearing is good, drowning is bad, where do those curves cross? So your point is really a good point. And what the Coast Guard is coming around to is saying, we'd rather have more people wear them, even if as a percentage, more people drown.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Now, where would it be safe to wear a lower buoyancy life jacket? Things that are observed. Dinghy regattas. Right? You got safety boats. Competition, wakeboard competitions. You got safety boats. Things where there is a controlled atmosphere, controlled environment. But as soon as you start getting out and just saying, go on, kids, go out, have a good time, and everybody's wearing these low buoyancy devices, and there's not a safety boat within 5 miles, you know, you run into risk. So it's a very good question. Generally, more buoyancy gives you a higher chance of survival, generally. Yes?
With all the high-tech stuff going on, I remember the little white belts that we used to wear for recreational.
Like a ski belt?
Yeah, ski belts.
Yeah.
Those are gone. But are there any things on the horizon for high-tech? I remember the spin lock inflatables were a little bit wider in the horseshoe and maybe a little more convenient to wear. Is there anything in the high-tech area that's or designs that are coming on that you see?
So, good question, because if you read the Underwriters Laboratory standard that controls inflatable life jackets is UL 1180. And UL 1180 is one of those standards that is very tightly written around, it's like how all IOR boats ended up looking the same, right? And all things that are in a, you know, that are on a tight specification, they all end up being the same. Such is the case with UL 1180. If you have a life jacket that meets UL 1180, it kind of looks like everybody else's life jacket. The new standard is based on a European standard, UL 12402, and that is much more of a performance-driven standard. In other words, the standard is not based on thou shalt stitch 12 stitches per inch, but thou shalt have a certain tear strength.
Yes.
And if you can achieve the tear strength with 6 stitches per inch, you can sell the life jacket. So the reason this is important, it's a long story, but the reason this is important is that this new UL standard, which is not yet the law of the land, should open up more options to how you achieve a performance standard, which would be great, because you know, these type-forming standards, everybody ends up looking the same, and we really want to have innovation.
Okay, two more questions, then we'll wrap up. Yes?
Changing subject. Okay. In the United States, as far as I know, there really aren't any standards, per se, on boat design, stability, and whatever. Whereas in the Europe, there are CE standards for dinghies, catamarans, keel boats, whatever.
Correct.
Is that kind of correct? Has that made any difference at all? The regulated standards, have that made any difference in the safety of Europe?
I don't know that I have an answer to that. So just to follow up on this, you know, Europe is very standards conscious, and the standards they use are from ISO, International Standards Organization. And so things like radar reflectors have a standard, and things like the stability of a Beneteau, it meets a standard, and all sorts of stuff has standards, much more so than we have in the US. We have voluntary standards from underwriters' laboratories. But for example, to your point, we don't have a standard for the stability of monohull sailboats in the US. We measure it, but we don't prohibit the sale of a vessel that doesn't meet the standard. So the question is, has the introduction of these standards suddenly made boating that much safer? And I don't know that it has. The other thing is that it's a political process. I mean, standards making, you'd like to get all the engineers together and they all think about deaths and how to prevent deaths, but it's a political process because you have manufacturers involved and you have the Coast Guard or the equivalent of the Coast Guard involved, and you have all these different groups that are involved. And one of the things, so I have great respect for Boat US. This is a little side note. I didn't used to because I used to compete with them and I thought that they were miserable SOBs, but I've gotten to know them. But as they start thinking about standards and restrictions, one of the things they think about is, will this hurt our members? Because if suddenly every boat needs to have hyperstability, you're going to turn people off from boating. So one of the things we always have to balance this with is the desirable effects or the possibly undesirable effects of having these ultra-safe boats or ultra-safe gear. The life jacket that you were talking about earlier is a $350 or $400 life jacket. If all of us had to buy that life jacket to meet the standard, some of us would choose not to go boating. So it's a very good question. And if you are a boating advocate, you have to absolutely have this feeling that you can make boating super safe, just make it so onerous that nobody does it. And even Boat US, who has this big, long safety track record, is not in favor of mandatory life jacket use because they feel that it will discourage people from going boating. So we've all got to have that balance. And of course, that's the discussion now, right, is over-regulation in the U.S. If you think it's bad in the U.S., try Europe. Okay. Hey, thank you very much.